Are you ready for the best damn sports radio show on the planet? Man Hour Nation, rise up.
I would like to personally welcome you to Man Hour at the Dark. Say that then. Where I bring you the host, Mike, Buck, and Cone.
You know we're coming to the
sports talk than what you about to hear right here. I second that.
Go. You know that it's us when we talking about sports. Giving you facts on the field to the core. Tune in, we need the support. 1 hour too short, then listen some more. On all your stations, not dropping no music. Starts like Adidas, but Nike just do it. Down four in the fourth, we go for the win. Michael, 2 seconds, we taking it in. Buck, Mike, and Combs, you know what's going on. Man, now we're out the dark, no LA, we a big spark. No fourth and inches, won't cut short. Got the best talking, it's all sports. Buzzing more than buzzer beaters. We coming live, all through your speakers, go.
And what is up, everybody? Michael Buckheiser here with the Man Hour. Head over to manhourradio.com. Check out the merchandise page and the blog section and, of course, the members only tab. When you become a members only on the Man Hour Nation, you get a hoodie. You get all access to us after the show, 10 p.m. East Coast time, Monday through Thursday. And you get all access to all the blogs as well. Of course, you get to talk to the man, the myth, the legend himself, Brandon BC Combs. What's going on, Brandon?
What is going on, Buck? Man Hour Nation, what is going on?
Man, it is another beautiful day. Like I don't know where the weather is out, like where like you are, but here, Combs, it's like 50 degrees. It feels like spring, man. And like I walked out into the yard and the grass is already starting to turn green, right? Oh man, and baseball was on the TV. Like you like honestly, Combs, this is the most excited I've been about a baseball season. In since 2015, to be honest, when the World Series.
I gotta tell you, somebody asked me today and said, you know, what do you think about what's going on with the president and with COVID? I said, stop.
Yeah.
Don't talk to me about the world today.
Nope. Sports.
Because baseball is on TV. The grass is green. The weather's turning warm. Everything is. There is nothing else I want. I don't want to talk about all that other stupid stuff. Let's just talk sports.
And to be honest, like Combs, like was it 2 weeks now ago when that snowstorm like absolutely wiped out basically from Texas up to like Chicago and down to Florida? Right, we have massive amount of snow. This made me appreciate baseball and spring training and this 50-degree weather that much more because, you know, we had like 8 inches of like snow here. I mean, it's not the 24 inches that they were calling for, WOKY, but we'll move past that. And I'm excited about baseball, to be honest. And you know what else we are kind of excited about? What is going on, Drew? We see you in the chat, big boy. Thank you for joining us tonight, Drew. And Tim, MLB is my president. Yeah, Tim, MLB is here and going to lead the world for the next, I don't know, till August or so.
Like, there's just something about once spring training games start and you start watching them on the TV, it's almost like it doesn't matter what the temperature is outside because it just feels warmer. Like, you know that in like the next 30 days, warm weather is going to be here. The start of the season's going to be here. You're going to be going out to the ballpark. In most stadiums, anyway, they're talking about you're going to the ballpark. Some stadiums are talking about 100% capacity.
Mm-hmm.
Fans are back in the stands. Fans are in the stands during spring training. It's amazing, man. I love every bit of it.
And what's even greater is that, you know, we are on Big X Sports Radio, 96.1 FM, Monday through Friday, normally 3 until 5 p.m., but every Tuesday and Friday through March and 2 weeks of like April, we are going to be bumped up to the 1 o'clock hour because of baseball. The Louisville Cardinals baseball plays, you know, their first pitches are usually about 3:05-ish or like or so. So the Big X has play-by-play of the Louisville Cardinals on every Tuesday, and Friday.
Wayne
moving
G
forward.
Reached out to me today. And he's like, you know, I went to go listen to the show on the radio today, and I got a baseball game. And I said, yeah, sorry, man. Tuesdays and Fridays, we're bumped up to 1 o'clock. I said,
yeah, I knew it was coming, like, in the back of my mind, but, like, it hasn't registered that it's March yet, right? We were, like, March 3rd, and, like, it hasn't registered that it's March yet. Like, almost like it's 2021. Like, the year's is almost a quarter over, and it hasn't registered that we're, like, in a new year yet either.
That's one of those things. I think that one of these years, maybe next year, we need to head out to spring training, whether it's Arizona or Florida.
Yeah.
We need to just go and have some fun. You know, I've never been to spring training. I've always wanted to go to spring training. Mm-hmm. I hear it is amazing to talk with players and chat with them. We could probably land some pretty damn good interviews while we're there.
Well, and with that, I think my wife would be definitely down to go to Florida because, you know, Florida's only like 8 hours from like us. So, I mean, it's an easy, right. easy 1 day drive. Now, Arizona, on the other hand, that might be a little rough.
Yeah. You know, Arizona's, you know, for me, it's the Cubs. That's where they're at.
Right.
That's where the Royals are at, too. So,
yeah.
You know, Arizona might be the play, but, you know, we'll figure it out when it comes to it. But it is, man. It's just something about this time of year. That makes you, you know, you appreciate everything, you know, especially the game of baseball. And then you start, the grass starts appearing from underneath the snow starts going away, birds are chirping, the sun is shining. Yeah, I mean, it's just, it's awesome, man.
Yeah, I mean, and like, let's talk a little bit about spring training here. Like, let's be honest. Florida is a more desirable state to, you know, than to Arizona. Like at least in Florida, we could tell our wives and kids, like, hey guys, we're going to the beach, or, you know, or we're gonna go do XYZ, and then, you know, me and you, Combs, slip off and watch some spring training games, and like, the bathroom line was crazy or something, right? But like Arizona, I don't think there's much happening in Arizona.
You gotta get on my level, buddy. So this is how we're gonna play this. We're taking the girls, and we're doing a couples trip. Okay.
And,
you know, right now Michelle's not watching because she went out, so I know she's not watching right now. So we take a couples trip, okay, and we go on the couples trip, and we buy them a 2 day spa trip. So it's just the girls' day. 2 days in the spa, and while they're at this, oh shit, she's watching.
I can see it. I can see this now, Combs. It, like, because like Cindy is the glass is always kind of like half empty, right? She'll be like, you are doing something nice for me. What do you want, right? So like, I rubbed her back the other day, and she's like, whoa, like, what do you want? I'm like, well, I heard Best Buy has PS5s back in stock. And she's like, no. I was like, ah. So like earlier tonight, like I got home early. I washed the plates and silverware and, you know, put them in the strainer. I picked up the house and she's like, what do you want? I'm like, I don't want anything yet, but my birthday is coming up and PS5s are probably still in stock. So
yeah. But no. See, even still, so we could just say, hey guys, we got you a 2 day spa trip. You guys go to your spa. We're gonna go do the guy thing. We're gonna go mingle with some baseball players. You guys don't want to be a part of that anyway. Go on ahead. Go do your thing. Go get your pedicures, your manicures, your facial, whatever it is that you have to
go sit in some mud for 4 hours. That'd be awesome.
It brings
out the complexion or something.
Yeah, exactly. Absolutely.
Yeah,
100%.
Just be sure to pick us up at 8 o'clock because we're going to need a DD. So, guys, we do have an exciting show happening for you. We have a big interview coming up on the after the first break. We are going to talk some UFC 259 with our man Hoffy. Yes, he is a baseball lackey, but he is also a UFC lackey as well. So Combs and Hoffy are going to dive deep into UFC 259-9 as well. And then, of course, we're going to talk some spring training baseball as well on the second hour of the show. We're going to talk a little bit about the mercy rule, baseball getting pushed back. And then we're going to speak on some football as well, because there was a big releasing today. But Combs, tell the people a little bit about our interview that's coming up here in about a couple minutes.
Yeah. So this, you know, this interview I got a chance to do a couple weeks ago. It's probably the most fun I've ever had in an interview. Down to earth guy Bob Picozzi of ESPN, retired broadcaster, is just one of the most genuine guys I've ever met in my life. And we talked for about 45 minutes after the interview, and ended up exchanging numbers and becoming friends. Like, he is a very good guy. He's a very knowledgeable guy. As you'll tell by the interview, if you haven't heard it already, once we get an interview, we start talking about baseball and the steroid era and all sorts of stuff. It was a really good interview, really good time. And, you know, he didn't shy away from any answers.
Very genuine. Probably the second best interview that we've ever had here on the Man Hour, hands down. And I think the best one was Joey, the bare knuckle fighter, just a couple weeks ago, like actually, Tory Anderson's just USC Ultimate Food Championship. Me and Combs would run that division. I mean, I love me some hot dog. I mean, I could eat any food right now. I'm starving.
I'm a fat kid, man. I could eat anything.
Yeah, I got my fat kid at ours as well. So many people don't recognize the name, you know, that we're interviewing. But once you hear his voice, you'll know exactly who it is. He will take you back absolutely. To, like, you know, your childhood listening to, you know, just listen to, like, his voice. It's a very soothing voice.
So if you've ever listened to UConn basketball, he was the voice of UConn basketball for a very long time, men and women. He did a lot of ESPN, their tournament stuff. Bob Picozzi was huge with their tournament stuff. College basketball was his bread and butter for ESPN. So as soon as you hear the voice, you'll know who he is.
You'll know exactly who it is. So we got Bob Picozzi coming up right here after the break right here on the Man Hour, guys. And if you're going to miss any part of the show whatsoever, head over to manhourradio.com. Check out the blogs. Check out the podcast, I should say. You can also download on iTunes, iHeartRadio, and Spotify. And you can join us live every Sunday through Thursday at youtube.com/manhour. That is 8 p.m. East Coast time. You can join us every Sunday through Thursday. So we'll be right back here, guys, on the Man Hour.
Man Hour Nation, welcome back to the show. I am very honored right now to be able to have a guest on with me at this time. Retired play-by-play man, 40-plus years in the business. If you ask me, he's one of the best to ever do it. His name is Bob Picozzi. Bob, how are we doing?
I'm doing great, Brandon. It's snowing here today, but you know, I've lived in New England since 1973, so I'm almost getting used to it.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I'm here in Chicago, and I spent like 15 years up in Vermont, so I know all about cold and snow and all that other good stuff. One of the big reasons why I can't wait to hopefully move southeast at some point in my life.
So you decided to escape the snow and move to tropical Chicago. I got it.
Yeah, exactly. You know, I grew up in Chicago and then went to Marine Corps, and after the Marine Corps, I spent about 15 years up in Vermont, so... You know, I've always been a cold weather guy, unfortunately, because I really do hate the snow, as even though I've never moved out of it. But it's definitely not for me. I'm a warm weather guy. I'm a baseball guy, so I like the summer, Bob.
Yeah, so do I.
All right. So how's retirement treating you? Do you miss calling games?
Well, yeah, I do. I'll always miss calling games. And, you know, you find I'm sure all retired play-by-play guys go through the same thing. You watch a game and you imagine what you would say at this moment, particularly, you know, late in a basketball game where it's close and there are a lot of timeouts, you wondered what you would say. And so I will always miss calling games, but I also enjoy retirement very much. I love the idea that when I get up in the morning, I don't have to be somewhere.
Right.
And there are times where I will go for days and days without getting in the car going anywhere, especially, you know, in the last year during the pandemic. I've only been out of the state of Connecticut once since the pandemic started. But I enjoy retirement very much. I enjoy my career, and I'm also enjoying my retirement very much.
Oh yeah, I'm sure. You know, us guys here at the Man Hour, myself, Buck Heister, and Wyatt, we all are doing this full time and trying to make something of it. But we also, all three of us also have full time jobs, and Wyatt also goes to school. He still hasn't graduated high school yet, so we know all about can't wait until we're in your shoes where we can just stay home and not have to worry about anything. But, you know, we're a long ways away from that anyway. So let's go into calling games. You know, it's something that's always been a dream of mine. Like, I really want to get into calling baseball. And I know Wyatt, he works a lot with the Indiana High School Association, and he calls a lot of their games. He just called the state championship games down in Southern Indiana. So we're really interested in the life of being a broadcaster itself. What is it like to become a broadcaster, for one, like the journey to it, and then how do you really get into being, you know, calling it at on the highest levels?
Well, it helps if that's what you always wanted to do. And it's what I always, well, what I always wanted to be, I always wanted to be a Major League Baseball player. But then when I realized that was not going to happen, then I decided to shift gears. And then I decided I want to become a play-by-play announcer. And I was 10 years old when I made that decision. And I never outgrew the dream. And everything that I did after that was with the idea of chasing that dream. Probably the most important decision I made was the decision to attend Seton Hall University because of the reputation of its campus radio station, WSOU. So I went there and was heavily involved in the radio station for 4 years. I got a chance to call 60 games while I was a student. So I had a lot of practical on-air experience, albeit at the college level by the time I graduated. And then it's just a case of working your way up. I didn't do any play-by-play in my first job out of college, but that was only 3.5 months long. And then I got a better job. And then I started doing high school basketball and high school football play-by-play. And then my third job, I did Yale basketball and then Fairfield University basketball. And then I kind of made a sideways step and became a local TV sports anchor for 19 years. And I had very few play-by-play opportunities during those 19 years. It was definitely a good career move at that point. But by the time I left there, the play-by-play opportunities had increased so much, especially on TV. And then that's when I started working for ESPN. And started doing games for them and also other, you know, I did some games for Fox. I did the UConn women's basketball local TV package. And so, I mean, I love doing it. And it's, I guess to answer your question, you know, the more games you do, the more opportunity people who hire have to hear you. And hopefully they like what they hear. And, you know, just like anything else with repetition, you ought to get better. If you don't, there's something wrong.
Yeah.
And so I think one of my great regrets is that I didn't keep track of how many games I did. I'm sure it was over 1,000, but I wish I knew the exact number. But I love them all. And whenever I watch a game, particularly college basketball, since the overwhelming majority of games I did were college basketball, it always reminds me of games I did in that arena. Oh, I remember when I did this and they played and that kind of thing. And I have a pretty good memory, and all of those memories are very warm ones.
Yeah. So, you know, that is what Wyatt is on the trajectory of. So Wyatt started out, you know, really early, sophomore year of high school, starts calling games and he knows that that's what he wants to do. Me, on the other hand, I've just always been a sports junkie. And, you know, after high school, I went into the Marine Corps. And then after that, I became a carpenter. And I always had this, you know, this little dream of wanting to just do sports all the time, talk sports like I am now. But, you know, I'm going to be 40 next month, Bob. So I'm a little late to the game. I've got some, you know, a whole lot of growing to do. This this man hour gig has been absolutely phenomenal. We are doing great things with it. But in order to get there and call games at the highest level, you know, you probably really do have to start early, don't you?
Well, it helps. But again, I made the transition. So I told you I was in local TV for 19 years. Yep. And then I left local TV because they didn't renew my contract. So they kind of they forced my hand. It was really the first and fortunately only time my career was ever at a crossroads. And I was 46 years old and I had a lot of radio play by play experience. I had done, I don't know, maybe 20, 25 games on TV during those 19 years at the local TV level. But, you know, I was taking a gamble at that point. I decided I didn't want to continue doing that.
Right.
Didn't want to continue being a local TV sports anchor. And I wanted to get back to my first love, which was play by play. So I picked the brains of at least 50 people to ask them whether they thought that was a realistic goal, you know, given my age. And the feeling was unanimous. I mean, I've known Bill Raftery forever. Bill was hired as the coach at Seton Hall when I was a junior, and I did the games for the student radio station. So I've known him since then and have stayed in touch with him since then. And so I remember out of all the advice I got, his probably resonated the most. And he said, yeah, he said, with your experience and your talent and your contacts, and all three of those are equally important. So you absolutely can do it. And he said, you'll probably find that it'll take a while to grow. But the more people who hear your work, the more people will want to hire you. And that's exactly the way it worked out. So I made that jump. It's not that I didn't have any play by play experience, but I was 46 years old when I made that jump, into doing TV play by play. In hindsight, I wish I did it much earlier because I think I would have had a chance to, first of all, I would have had a chance to enjoy so many more years of doing play by play. And I probably, there's no doubt in my mind, I would have a chance to ascend a little bit higher on the ladder. The best way to start is to do it at the local high school level and to understand that you're not going to make much money. Right. And then you just listen to your tapes. And also it's a good idea to ask someone to critique your tapes. Mm-hmm. And when I was a senior in college, you're bemoaning the fact you're about to turn 40. I'm amused. On June 4th, I'll turn 70. And I'm a Jersey guy. So if you're my age and you wanted to become a play-by-play announcer and you're from New Jersey or New York or Connecticut, there's a real good chance your hero, your idol, was Marv Albert. And he was mine. I was always a Rangers fan. So I was never a Knicks fan, but I used to listen to Marv all the time when he was only on radio. And my college roommate senior year said, why don't you send Marv a tape and see if he'll critique it? I said, what, are you out of your mind? You know, why would he do that? He says, what do you have to lose? The cost of a stamp and, you know, and you don't get your tape back. So I did it. And about 10 days later, the tape came back in the mail with a handwritten note that said, I listened to your tape. If you want me to go over it with you, call me at this number at such and such a time. And I did. And he spent about 20 minutes on the phone with me. And it was great.
Oh, wow.
And I can remember to this day some of the things he told me. And so, as you can imagine, if he did that for me, he had no idea who I was, he must have done it for everyone. Right. So I decided at that point, if ever anyone thinks that I have anything to say that might be of some value to them, I will always do it. And that's been my mantra ever since then. And people all the time, they're asking me if I'll watch or listen to their tapes. And I do. And I give them some critique. And they, you know, from doing it for all these years, you know, you get pretty good at recognizing things and, you know, where they can prove this is good, this is not so good, and that kind of thing. But the only way you get better is to listen to your tapes. and to hear what you're doing and to hear things. Probably the greatest mistake you make is you tend to be repetitious, saying the same thing over and over again, whereas you could use a different word or words to describe the same thing and not be so repetitive. But the only way you're going to find that out is by watching and listening to your work.
That's great information. For me, that's very, very encouraging to hear, because I really thought that I was starting late in the game. But to hear that, you know, there's still a shot to do things at a high level, it's very encouraging.
Well, let me just point this out, Brandon. And you being in Chicago now, you'll appreciate this. One of the people who reached out to me to ask them to watch their tape, and in this case, it was listen to the tape. It was radio, and it was when he was in college. And then he sent me another one when he was out in the business after a year or two. And he was grateful for the advice I gave him. It was a guy named Jason Benetti.
Okay. Yeah.
He was a senior at Syracuse, and it's funny what a small world it is. I referenced my college roommate John Hugo Myers from Towson, Maryland, and John's nephew was a student at Syracuse and was a very good friend of Jason. And one time over a long weekend, or maybe it was spring break, Jason came to Maryland to visit Scott, John's nephew, and John met him and he asked him what he's studying. When he found out what he was studying, he said, "Well, you know who you ought to talk to? You ought to talk to my college roommate, so-and-so." So Jason did, and I listened to it. And then a couple of years later, I'm doing the Big East women's basketball tournament, the semifinals at the Hartford Civic Center, and DePaul is playing UConn in one of the games. And I'm at the morning shoot-around for DePaul, and after the shoot-around, you meet with the coaches. And I've known Doug Bruno forever, and Doug said, "Bob, do you mind if our radio play-by-play guy sits in on this conversation?" And I said, "No, not at all." And he says, "Bob, this is Jason Benetti." And I didn't even know that Jason was doing the games. So, and then, you know, then Jason and I wound up working on the same team at ESPN. So, yeah, I'm always willing to do that. And I strongly recommend people who are just starting out in the business that they try to do the same thing, that they get someone in the business to listen to their work and offer a critique.
That's great. And, you know, Jason Benetti is a fine play-by-play guy for the Chicago White Sox. I am a Chicago Cubs fan, and they actually just took a guy from our play-by-play booth, which is Len Casper, over to their side to do radio. And he's leaving TV to do radio. And a lot of the Cubs fans were you know, upset, obviously. He's going to the South Side. We love listening to Len Casper call games. But his preference has always been radio. Like, he's always wanted to do radio, and he felt like this was the perfect time, the perfect opportunity for him to jump over to the radio side and be able to call games. What for you, what is the difference, or is there a preference between TV and radio, and what would you prefer to do?
Well, I did a ton of radio at the beginning of my career, and then I did all TV in the last 20 years, with one exception. I did one game for ESPN Radio, and I was terrible because I hadn't done a radio game in years, and I knew the transition would be tough, and it was 10 times tougher than I thought it would be. There's no question it requires much more ability and skill to do it on radio. It's not even close. When you're making the transition from radio to TV, the first thing, most important thing you have to learn to do is to cut down on what you say, you know, by tenfold, because you would drive people crazy if you talked as much in doing a game on TV as you did on radio. But the transition going from TV to radio, you have to remember that you have to keep talking. You know, so this was I was doing a Florida-Georgia football game, which was a really good assignment for ESPN Radio. And it's just tough to break a 20-year habit. And, you know, as they break the huddle, you have to lay out the offense and, you know, how many wide receivers there are and how many tight ends and where they are. And is the quarterback under center? Is he in the shotgun, et cetera, and et cetera. And just remind you, I'm sure if I had done another game, I would have been that much better. But I can understand Len feeling that way. Now, unfortunately, and it's not the least bit fair, you are compensated much greater doing games on TV than you are in radio. So it's an interesting move that Len made, but I admire him for doing that if that's his first love. And also, baseball is a great radio sport.
Yes.
It's a much greater – baseball is a much greater radio sport than any because of the pace of play. I love – I'm a – baseball is my favorite sport. I love nothing more than to sit on the beach because, I, you know, being from New Jersey, I love the beach and listening to a baseball game.
Yeah, people call me crazy because – you know, if I'm driving around and I can't watch the game on TV, and now I'm a Cubs fan, but I'm a baseball guy. Like I'll watch 1,000 games a year, and not even, you know, that's a little bit light for me, is 1,000 games a year, because I watch as much baseball as I can, but I really love listening to the games on the radio. One of my, you know, favorite color commentators came from sports radio, which was on the Cubs side, which was Ron Santo. The way and how enthusiastic he was about the Cubs, I just love listening to it. I love listening to the game. There were times where I would turn down the TV broadcast while I'm watching it on TV and turn up the radio broadcast just so I could listen to Ron Santo, you know, on the game, on the call. And that is it's something about when you love the game, you can actually sit there and listen to it on the radio. And a lot of people don't understand that. So I actually love the fact that you just said that, because it's one of my great loves as well.
Well, I think you have to love baseball to understand it. And I love baseball, and I'm sure you sound like you would understand it. To try to explain to someone who doesn't like baseball why you love it, you know, they'll never understand it, you know?
Yeah. Oh, absolutely.
So, you know, I have Sirius in my car, and I mean, that's the greatest invention since ice cream,
right?
Because you know, you can listen to, you know, what I'll do is I'll listen to all the games, you know, at each commercial break, I'll try another broadcast, because yep. In addition, you know, to enjoy listening to the game, I like to listen to all the different announcers.
Correct. Yeah, that's the same way that I am. I love watching. So I'll watch Cubs games, and sometimes I'll flip over if I'm out of market. I'll flip over to a Cubs game and flip over to the visitors' broadcast just to hear what their broadcasters are like.
Right.
It is something that I do love. One thing about baseball, and I'm curious to hear your take about it, and we've gotten into this subject a lot here lately on our show, is the steroid era and how the Baseball Writers of Association of America are, you know, dealing with the steroid era, like not voting anybody in this year. So I'm curious to hear your take on the steroid era, because my take is that baseball made a ton of money off of the steroid era. And when their hand got caught in the cookie jar, so to speak, they kind of threw the players under the bus. And now the players are really the ones paying the price for it. I'm curious to hear what your take is on that.
Well, I certainly understand why anyone, not the least of which are the Hall of Famers themselves,
mm-hmm.
who feel the way they do about people who use PEDs and how it was not a level playing field. It's such a complicated issue, because if you follow the career, you know, Barry Bonds, I don't believe ever tested positive, but I think. You're not going to find many people who don't believe that he used PEDs.
Right.
Roger Clemens was in the Mitchell Report, and certainly you're not going to find many people who didn't believe he used them. And Alex Rodriguez obviously did test positive. But I think if you follow the game closely, you have to understand they were great players before we think they started using. I mean,
right.
I don't believe Roger Clemens used until after he left Boston. Well, he's a pretty good pitcher for the Red Sox. He won 3 Cy Young Awards and an MVP award there.
Right.
But then, so that's the part that makes it difficult. You know, how do you navigate that? Were Clemens and Bonds and A-Rod Hall of Fame players, you know, before they started using PEDs? The answer could very well be yes.
Right.
And if the answer is yes, I think I would vote for them. That's why when people ask me who's the greatest at this and that, I'm going to give you two different answers. One that completely disregards PEDs and one that disqualifies people because of PEDs.
Right.
If you ask me who the greatest left fielder was in baseball history, if you disregard the PEDs, it was Barry Bonds.
Correct.
But if you want to disqualify him because we think that he used PEDs, it would be Ted Williams. And, you know, and I would do that. It's I think Clemens is the greatest right-handed pitcher in baseball history if you discount the PEDs when you look at all of his accomplishments. So I don't know. I think I probably side with the Bob Costas school of thought that, you know, I'd probably vote for them, but there should be a notation on their plaque that is applicable and that is fact-based about whatever their involvement was with PEDs.
Yeah, and I'm a big – it's funny. The ball that sits over here on my shoulder is actually a Barry Bonds autographed baseball. And I'm a big fan of Barry Bonds. I think Barry Bonds is the greatest player to ever step on the field. You look at the numbers. You look at the things that he did throughout his career. I'm on that bandwagon that Barry Bonds is the greatest of all time. But then you look at the – like I was talking about Baseball Writers of America not voting for these guys – It's almost like they decide who they like because there's a overwhelming majority that believe that next year a guy like David Ortiz is going to get in, and he has a positive test on his record, but he is very well liked among the media, and Barry Bonds was not for whatever reason, you know. So I feel like, and then you look at guys like Ty Cobb who got in and their background and stuff that you hear about them, and it's almost like they're drawing a moral compass line, and you tend to wonder, you know, where does that moral compass line stop? But
well, I mean, you know, Pete Rose is in his own separate category because that has been the law of the land since the right. Black Sox scandal. Yeah. It is a rule. And the sign is on the clubhouse door everywhere. So he violated that rule. And not only does everyone know what the rule is, but they know what the penalty is that comes with the rule.
Agreed.
And there's a reason why, since the Black Sox scandal, there's only been really one person that's been involved and linked with betting, right? And it's right, because it's a deterrent, and the deterrent has worked. You know, Ty Cobb, I'm sure what you're referring to is a pretty good – indication through history that Ty Cobb was a racist. Yep. Well, being a racist doesn't directly affect, look, I hate, there's no one on earth I despise more than racists, but that doesn't affect what you did on the field. Using steroids does. So I'm not so sure I agree with you with the popularity or the unpopularity of, I don't know who would be, I don't know who would be a good case. The problem with Andy Pettit was very popular with the media and very popular with the fans. The problem is his Hall of Fame credentials are borderline anyway. Personally, I would vote for him because he's got 18 postseason wins, which is the most ever, and he played on 5 championship teams. And also, he is I'm pretty sure about this. I think there are only 2 pitchers in baseball history who finished 100 games over 500 and who are eligible for the Hall of Fame who are not yet in the Hall of Fame. And they are Roger Clemens, and we know why, and the other one's Andy Pettit. So, and you know, Pettit hasn't received any significant support so far. I'm not suggesting that Pettit's resume is anywhere near as great as Clemens' resume, but I don't think you're going to find anyone who says, well, I'm not voting for Pettit because I don't like him, because Pettit was universally liked, and you know, the way he handled it, he fessed up. He said, yes, I did it. This is why I did it, to rehab from an injury. But I don't know what the answer to that is. I can certainly appreciate how the hardline Hall of Famers, and most of them are hardliners, don't want to have anything to do with people with a PED history getting into their hallowed halls.
Yeah, and it's funny that you mentioned Pete Rose, because that's one of the arguments I always get is, well, if you're going to let these guys in, then Pete Rose definitely needs to be in. Well, you know, what changed? I used to be on that camp, too. I used to be like, well, what Pete Rose did on the field, I mean, it's unquestionable. But the gambling on the game, what changed my mind was actually a conversation with one of his former teammates, and he said, look, he's never getting in, and he shouldn't be in because he gambled on the game, and it's the one rule that we all know, and he broke it. So that's kind of what changed my mind was that view of it. You know, I think the steroids era is just a different topic, and it's a debate that is going to go on forever, I'm sure. But you know, I guess we'll see. Time will tell whether or not these guys get in. I believe that they should be in. Others believe that they shouldn't be in. And ultimately, I don't get a vote. So that's the one thing that remains to be the same, as I don't get a vote, so I don't get to say who gets in. So before I let you go here, I do want to get back into your times as a play-by-play guy. I got a couple of fun questions I'd like to ask you. First and foremost, what is your favorite memory calling a game?
Well, I don't think that there's a definitive answer to that question. So I'll answer it two different ways. I had done, as I said, games on local radio at the beginning of my career. And then when I went to work for ESPN, I did games on a regional basis. Back then, the Big East Network, the games were produced by ESPN Regional Television in Charlotte. And they were just that. They were regionally televised. They would always be in the markets of the two participating teams. And they would frequently be on in other Big East markets where the team in that market didn't have a game that night. They might be on as many as 40 different TV stations, but they weren't nationally televised. And the first time that I did a game on national TV I also did a lot of women's college basketball, was an NCAA women's basketball tournament game, a second round game at the University of Texas in March of 2002. And as I was walking into the Irwin Arena in Austin that night, I was well aware of the fact that this was the first time I was going to do a game that was going to be on nationally. It doesn't change the way you prepare, nor change the way you call the game. And I never once thought about it once I was on the air, but it kind of hit me as I walked into the arena. But probably the most memorable game I called, I did the America East Men's Basketball Championship game for a number of years. And it was a Stony Brook at Albany game. And the America East is one of these leagues where they play the championship game on the home floor of the higher seed of the two finalists. And it's, the atmosphere is off the charts, right? Because it's obviously a one bid league. You either win the conference championship game and go to the NCAA tournament, or you go home. You know, there's never going to be an America East team that's going to get an at-large berth in the NCAA. Right. So Albany had a player from Australia named Peter Hooley. And Peter, between the time he signed his letter of intent to go to Albany and the time he actually left for school, his mom was diagnosed with cancer. So at first he didn't want to go, but she convinced him to go. Don't worry about it. You know, I'll be fine. I'll get the treatments. You know, your dad's here, your sister's here to take care of me. I'll be fine. So he went off to school, and then I think it was his senior year. I'm not 100% sure about that. His mom started her condition took a turn for the worse, and his dad said, you know, I think you better come see her. So he took a leave of absence and he went home, and he essentially sat vigil in her hospital room for 14 days, and then she passed away. And then he took a little more time off, and this is during the basketball season, and then he decided it's time to go back to school. And his dad and sister went with him because they felt he would need that support system. And they didn't stay very long because they saw that he had another family, the Albany basketball team and the coaches and the student body, who all knew about it. And he had a tremendous support system there. So they went back home. So now fast forward, it's the conference championship game, and his team is losing by 2 points. And he hits a three-pointer from the top of the circle with 3 seconds left to win the conference championship game and send them to the NCAA tournament. And the students stormed the floor, and someone had an Australian flag and draped it around him. And I did the game with Tim Welsh, the former Iona and Providence college coach. And Tim interviewed Peter on the floor, and he's got the Australian flag around his shoulder. And the shot wasn't clean. It was a rim rattler and went in. And he said, I think my mom, you know, helped with a little body English there to send it in. It was just, so it was the whole scene. You know, I think we did a pretty good job of setting up the storyline early in the broadcast and then having to revisit the storyline when he made the game winning shot. So for those reasons, that was memorable. It's all, the America East is always the first championship game that's played on that Saturday before Selection Sunday. Yep. And there are about 15 conference championship games that are played that day. And so ESPN has games wall to wall, and they, you know, at halftime and between games, they're going to the studio, and they must have played that highlight, you know, 20 times over the course of the day.
Yeah.
And so, and then the next day, you know, they had Peter on live and everything. So that was an unforgettable moment for me.
Yeah, that's one of those moments that every time you see it gives you chills, or hear it gives you chills. Those are always my favorite sports moments. For me, it's always going to be the last out of 2016 World Series. Like, I still get tears when I watch it, just sure. Because, you know. But those stories are always my favorite. Now, the last question I want to ask you before you get out of here might be the toughest question I've asked you since we've been on. Who was the color analyst that you had the most fun with during your career?
Well, that's not tough at all. I mean, first of all, I had fun with a lot of them, but the one that I had the most fun with was Bill Raftery.
Okay.
And it has everything to do with the fact that I've known him forever. And it was interesting. Of course, Bill was at the very top of the food chain. As you know, he does the Final Four for CBS. So he always did games for Big East, for ESPN and CBS. And then when the Big East fell apart and rechristened as a new league, Fox got the TV rights. So since he had been so closely identified with the Big East throughout the history of the league, first as a coach at Seton Hall and then as a broadcaster, he decided he wanted to continue doing Big East games. So he left ESPN, and he now does games for CBS and Fox. And for whatever reason, in his final year at ESPN, they assigned him to work with me for three games. And it was a blast. The games were a blast. The night before was a blast. And, you know, I was an ESPN Radio Sports Center anchor for 18 years. And yep. First 14 years was during the show Mike and Mike. So one time Bill was a guest on Mike and Mike. And the format changed over the years. But for a while, they would have they would go to a commercial break. And out of the break, they would have my Sports Center. And then Golic and Greenberg would come back on. So Bill was the guest in the next segment. So my Sports Center aired, and then they came on and they welcomed in Bill Raftery, and Bill had been on hold. You know, he was on the phone, and you know, on hold, you hear programming. So he heard me in the Sports Center. And so they welcomed him in, and he said, it was nice to hear my old friend, Bob Picozzi. And, you know, this is like at 6:20 in the morning or 6:40 in the morning. And he said, when Bobby was at Seton Hall, the only time he was ever awake at this hour was when he was just getting in from the night before. And so, which, first of all, is only partially true. And talk about the pot calling the kettle black when it comes to that. But it was so much fun doing games with Bill. He's one of the greatest guys I've ever met. I still stay in touch with him all the time. He's been great to me throughout my career. He's helped me in many, many ways. And so getting a chance to do a couple games with him was just an absolute blast.
That's awesome. That is awesome. All right. Well, Bob, you know, thank you for joining us here on the show today. I will talk with you here in a few seconds just off camera. But I appreciate everything you have. It's been an absolute honor, been an absolute pleasure. Thank you for joining the Man Hour.
It is my pleasure, man. We'll be right back.
check the mic and make sure it sound right, boys.
And welcome back to the Man Hour, guys. Michael Buckeiser along with Brandon Combs here. Let me bring BC onto the camera, man. BC, that was a great interview with Bob Picozzi. If you guys have not heard that interview before, we did that about a week ago before we were on the Big X here, and we figured the Big X crowd would like to hear it because Bob Picozzi is a staple of college basketball for many, many years, and we are in college basketball country right here. So hopefully you guys enjoyed that interview. Combs, every time I've listened to that interview at least 12 times now, and I pick more information out of that interview every time because he is like literally giving you the knowledge book here, and you can read it and you're like, oh, I missed that, and like I literally pull stuff out every time that he like he talks, and I try to better myself each and every show, and some of the advice that he did earlier or that he gave us that first part of the interview, go back and listen to yourself. See what words that you use a lot. I use the word like a lot. I mean, like. So I try to subconsciously say, don't use that word. And then sometimes when you're like, don't use that word, you're like, what other word can I use? A thesaurus is your key there. Like, the thesaurus has really saved my life. So I'm really glad to have that on.
He was amazing. And then even backstage, like, he had more advice to offer. And, you know, he was one of those guys who's like, hey, look, if you ever have any questions, I'm here to help you out. Like, he's not one of those guys that's into business and, like, you can't be bothered. He's like, look, if you need help, if you want to know how you sound, whether or not you sound good, you sound bad, or if something, you know, if you need to know something, call me. Let me know. I'll listen to it, and I'll tell you. And that's just, I mean, you can't get anything better than that, from, especially from a guy like that.
Yeah, coming from a guy that I simply reached out to, like, have an interview with, and he gave us the Bible to basically do what we wanted to do, right? You know, and
amazing guy.
We are following step by step there. But speaking of giving us a Bible here, Hoffy, the baseball lackey himself, let's welcome this man on to the show, Combs. Are you ready? Woo! There it is, the man, Hoffy, the baseball lackey. But tonight, Hoffy, you got to become the UFC lackey. UFC 259 main event is coming up. Are you ready, Hoffy?
Oh, I'm ready.
That was weak. I said, are you ready, Hoffy?
I'm ready!
There we go. There we go. All right, so we don't want to get a copyright infraction there, so I better turn that down here a little bit. But that song gets me excited every time. Hell's Bell by AC/DC. So, Hoffy, tell the people a little bit about your UFC fandom here before we, you know, basically let you and Combs break it down.
I mean, so me and Combs are going at it almost every Saturday while the events are going on. So he said, let's go at it while we, you know, do Man Hour.
Yeah, man. And, man, like, honestly, Hoffy, you are slowly becoming a part of the show. You'll be on his, you know, every week with your MLB power rankings, even though they're complete trash. But we will be with you every Monday here on the Big X Sports Radio 96.1 from 3 p.m. till 5 p.m. So, Combs, it is your time to shine, man. Let's talk a little bit of UFC, man.
Yeah, man. Hoffy, I don't know about you, but this might be one of the greatest cards that they've ever put together.
I agree. Yeah.
They, I mean, even the prelims, man. I mean, the early prelims are good.
Even the early prelims.
Yeah. But the main event of the prelim with Dominic Cruz and Casey Kenney, man, that could be a main event.
Yep. Yeah. So, and you got your boy Tim Elliott on the early prelims, too. And I mean, on a fight night card, he could be a co-main event.
Yeah, absolutely. Also on the early prelims, we got Sean Brady and Jake Matthews. Man, that's going to be a hell of a fight. Sean Brady undefeated going up against Jake Matthews. Let's start there. What do you think about? Have you caught much of Sean Brady yet?
And I was actually watching some highlights. Yeah, I was watching some highlights of him today just to kind of refamiliarize myself with him. But yeah, I mean, the guy is well rounded all the way around. And I mean, when he comes in for, you know, a flurry of punches, he's going to hit you with a, you know, three or four, you know, piece combo. And I think he is going to give Jake Matthews, you know, I think he's going to beat him, to be honest with you, even though Jake Matthews is the UFC veteran when it comes to this fight.
Yeah, I really think that Brady has what it takes. I think that this is going to be one of those phone booth style fights. You know, I know that Sean Brady is with Team Gracie. You know, traditionally those Team Gracie guys like to take the fight to the ground and win the fight either via submission or just wear you out for three rounds. But I really think this is going to be a phone booth type of fight. I think these guys are going to go blow for blow. Somebody's getting knocked out in this fight, I think.
Yeah. Brady doesn't end up with, you know, a lot of knockouts. It's most of the time he goes to a decision. But yeah, I do think that this one is going to be, maybe a first round, you know, knockout to, you know, in this one.
Yeah, for sure. And then, you know, look, man, I've really been into the women's divisions lately. There are a lot of really good fights that come out of the women's divisions. And this fight between Lavina Souza and Amanda Lemos, look, man, both fighters out of Brazil, both of them are just heavy throwers. I mean, they hit hard. These girls, both of them, I believe, could throw with some guys in the lightweight division of UFC because they just throw so hard, man. You know, Lemos is a southpaw, so sometimes it's hard to fight a southpaw because you're not used to that stance and trying to get in there. Where do you see this one going?
I think Lemos is going to win this one. I mean, she throws in volume. And I think that's what's going to do it here. I was looking at the stats earlier. I can't pull it up. I think she averages like four significant strikes a minute, in comparison to Souza averaging, I believe one. So I think that's where it's, you know, these women fights tend to go the distance. So it tends to be who landed some of the, you know, the bigger punches, who got some of the better, you know, better flurries and such. And I think that's where Lemos will take over with some of the, you know, the more significant strikes throughout the fight.
Now, a lot of times when you get, especially in the women's division, we're seeing it now, and they're even talking about outlawing it right now. But you see when you're fighting, when somebody's going up against a style of fighter like Lemos is, who loves to go for the head, loves to throw a lot of punches, the fighter who doesn't strike as much will go for them leg kicks to try to keep them away and keep them off guard. And I have seen some nasty leg kicks in the women's division. I watched a fight last week where the girl's leg was black and blue before the end of the first, and you could visibly see it as she's walking around how black and blue her leg was. I mean, what do you think that if Souza does go with those leg kicks, do you think she can keep Lemos at bay?
Yeah, I mean, that's going to be a key talking point that I was going to bring up later on in some of the main event fights. I mean, we saw it with Conor McGregor versus Poirier. McGregor, you know, had Poirier, you know, on his back foot, had him, you know, dazed several times and won that first round. And me and you looked at it and said, oh, boy, you know, second or third round. But those kicks, like we said, have been a huge game changer in the past. You know, it's really new on that outside, you know, on the outside of that calf. So, yeah, I think with the ladies, that's going to be a huge thing. And they're both Brazilian, you know, jiu-jitsu guys or ladies, I should say. So I think this fight does go to the ground and we see a great grappling match. But I do think Lemos, you know, like I said, gets some of those more significant strikes. And that's right. What will get her the decision.
So then we'll skip ahead here a little bit. Let's go to the main event of the early prelims. We've got Tim Elliott versus Jordan Espinosa. To me, this is a mismatched fight. I think Espinosa is just, I think he's just more well-rounded than Elliott is. I think he's stronger than Elliott is. I think he throws more strikes than Elliott does. He's got better takedown. He's got better defense. He's got better everything. Is there any way Elliott pulls out this fight?
I mean, I believe he can. I believe he can, you know, beat Tim Elliott, dance around the octagon. I mean, it's going to be difficult in this, you know, the 25-foot octagon compared to the normal size 30-foot. But, yeah, I think if he can, you know, just dance around and get in, find his spots, get out, get some of those leg kicks and find a way to get the fight to the ground, he could very well end up with a submission win.
Yeah, I mean, Espinosa, not only does he have better takedown defense than Elliott does have takedowns, But he's also got that 3-inch reach advantage.
Yeah.
And a 3-inch reach advantage is a huge advantage.
Yeah. And he's good with a takedown defense, too. He's like 83%. So he's going to be tough to take down. But like I said, that's where those side, you know, calf kicks are going to have to, you know, help Elliott out. And hope, you know, one of those diamond rolls or something and just catch the ankle lock. But yeah, outside of that, it's going to be difficult for him to win because Espinosa is going to, you know, going to be the better all around boxer fighter, you know, when it comes to all that. So unless this fight gets to the ground, I don't see, you know, Elliott having much of a chance.
And that's the thing. I mean, even with the leg strikes, I just don't think that Espinosa can keep his distance enough that the leg, he's not going to be able to hit him with leg strikes. He's going to be too far away from him.
Yeah, three-round fight compared to a five-round is a huge difference, too. So, you know, he's still going to be fresh into that third round. If you're talking fourth, five-round, that's when Elliott might have the upper hand, you know, because he carries a lot more body mass than Elliott. But with a three-round fight, it's not going to be too difficult.
All right, so then we head over to the prelims. You know, another fight I think is just going to be one-sided here is the first fight in the prelims, which is Rogério Bontorin versus Kai Kara-France. Bontorin is a beast, and he's an up-and-comer in the division. You know, the flyweights to me are always the fun. I don't know why, but the flyweight division just always seems to be so action-packed, usually has the best finishes, and I love this division. But this kid is the real deal. He can beat you with the strikes. He can beat you with the submission. He's got so many different things that he can do. I don't see where Kara-France can come away with anything unless he just hits him, you know, with a surprise somewhere, whether he switches up styles, whether he, you know, decides to take it to the ground instead of striking, because Kara-France does love to strike. If that's the only way I see that Kara-France has a chance. Have you watched Bontorin?
Yeah, I have, but I do think France pulls this one out. I mean, he is a training partner of Volkanovski at City Kickboxing. So, I mean, those New Zealand kids, they're good. There's another fight that's coming up on this card. I'm not sure if a lot of people are familiar with him, but he's Israel's training partner. And I think after we see him fight, you're gonna know the name, and he's gonna be in that top 15 real soon as well. But I think this kid, this Kara-France kid, is gonna put on a show, and I think he actually, I think he's the favorite. If I'm not, can you know, he if is I'm not the wrong favorite. There, but yeah, I do think he wins this fight.
Wow. See, I'm on the exact opposite there. I think Bontorin is going to be too much for him. I think that Bontorin at a plus 115 is easy money if you're on the betting line. I really like a lot of the going through this, and we'll talk about this in a little bit here, but I like a lot of the underdogs, and I think a lot of the underdogs should actually be the favorite in some of these fights, this being one of them for sure.
Yeah, I think France will have the reach advantage. And like I said, City Kickboxing is just on a whole nother level when it comes to striking and their kickboxing. So I think he gets it. You know, it's a three-round decision. I mean, most of his fights end up being a submission or a knockout. I think this one ends up being, like you said, a phone booth battle. But I think this is, you know, potentially fight of the night. But all three rounds, I think, are going to be scored on the scorecard at the end of it.
Yeah. And moving on to the next fight here in the prelims, we've got Joseph Benavidez versus Askar Askarov. And look, Askarov hasn't lost in the UFC, hasn't lost in his MMA career. He's 12-0-1. That being said, you know, the underdog here, Joseph Benavidez, 28-7. I think Benavidez knocks Askarov out. I do. I think he gives him his first loss. I think he knocks him out. I really love Benavidez. I've watched him fight a lot in the UFC.
He's up there in age. And those last two fights, man, his last two fights are against Figueiredo, and he's been knocked out. So I don't know. I question him now.
Is a much different fighter than Askarov is. And, you know, his
other Benavidez looks slow. He looks scared. He just, and I want to see that, but I do feel like he's going to come out. He might be comfortable. I mean, it's not, like you said, it's not the same guy, but I do think, I do think Askarov does get the W on this.
His two losses to Figueiredo both were in championship fights. And you know, look, Figueiredo's a different animal, but you go back to, you know, when, he beat Formiga, and then again, when he beat Perez, Both of those wins were by knockout. Both of those guys are closer to the style of Askarov than Figueiredo. So I really like Benavidez here. I'm going with the upset here. I'm taking Benavidez to knock out Askarov. Let's see here. What's the next fight here? Lost my place. Oh, yes. So my favorite name in the sport. I don't know why, but this guy is my favorite name. His name is Song Yadong. Okay. Yep,
just because I don't think I could pick against him.
I love that name, Song Yadong, and he really is a beast. I love this kid. I love the way he fights. However, Kyler Phillips is, when you see him, you'll know what I'm talking about. If you don't know UFC and you're going to watch this weekend, what you're going to realize is Kyler Phillips is a maniac. The guy is absolutely insane. And he all, like, guys like that just scare me. Not only that, but the 5-inch reach advantage that he has.
Absolutely. I was going to bring that up. Yep. Yeah. 67% knockout percentage. So he's.
Yeah. I'm going all day with the underdog here in Kyler Phillips. Even though I love the name. I don't know why. Song Yadong is just a great name. But Kyler Phillips, I'm going with the American. I'm going with the knockout. I am going with Kyler Phillips. The dude is a beast.
Yeah, I had originally looked at, you know, Song Yadong. Like I said, you can't go against him. But the more I looked into the fight, the more I looked into, you know, I don't see, like you said, I don't see us going past the first round. I think Phillips knocks him out in one.
Yeah, absolutely. I think it's going to be it's going to be interesting. Song Yadong is quick. I mean, he's very, very quick and elusive. But if Kyler catches him, man, it's going to be night-night.
Yeah, I've seen him get caught a couple times, and I feel, you know, by lesser talent, I feel. So I feel like he is going to, you know, his chin's going to be vulnerable.
Yeah, for sure. And then we have Dominic Cruz versus Casey Kenney, which is the main event of the prelims, which really, to be honest with you, could be a fourth main event of the main card. Dominic Cruz here is the underdog. Another underdog that I just don't understand why he's the underdog.
I agree 100% on that one.
I've watched this guy a lot. And I just don't know what makes him the underdog in this fight. Look, I get it. You know, he's coming off of two losses, but his two losses are to Cejudo and Garbrandt. You know, two really damn good fighters. But before
and
that,
he was injured against Garbrandt.
Right, exactly. And that was a decision. You know what I mean? So it's not like he got knocked out. It's not like he tapped. Cejudo did knock him out. But before that, he beat Faber, beat Dillashaw, beat some really big name opponents. I like Dominic Cruz, man. And in this fight, I'm going with Dominic Cruz as well.
Yeah, I agree. I you know, being that I'm in California, I follow him. You know, he's out of San Diego, so I follow his Instagram. He's been working his butt off, and I do think that that Cejudo fight, you know, he's got something to prove after this one. Like you said, two in a row. You know, he's a UFC commentator. He's brilliant minded. I think right. He knows that, you know, a lot of, you know, commentary, you know, ability might, you know, be in play here. If he goes, you know, three in a row, he might not have as many of those, you know, commentary chances. So I think he has a big performance, and I think he lets the kid know that it's not quite his time, and that, you know, he's still here to reign on his division.
Right. Yeah, no, I wholeheartedly agree. And then we're going to get into the main card. But before we pick some fights in that main card, for those of you still listening to us and want to watch the fights this weekend, we are going to go ahead and live stream the fights. So you can actually watch the fights with us here on the Man Hour. It is going to be $5 to get into the link. So there's a link we have to send out so that we could stream the fight. And you guys can come in and watch the fights instead of paying $69.99 like I'm going to stream the fight. You could actually pay $5 to come on in, watch the main event in its entirety. And this main card, I'm telling you right now, is the best I've ever seen in the UFC. We've got four champions, three title fights. I mean, just absolutely phenomenal. So if you have not gotten into UFC, or even if you are into UFC, I know, Hoffy, you said you're in. I know we have Mike LeBlanc who said he's in. And I know you guys are both big UFC guys. But for those of you who are like, you know, I don't want to pay that much to watch a fight. I don't want to see, you know, I don't know enough about it. This is your chance to go ahead, come chat with us. I mean, we're going to be talking junk all through the fight. Come chit-chat with us. Watch the fights for $5. $5 you can watch these fights and learn about the UFC. And we'll be there to talk with you guys. So let us know if you want in. We will send you the link. We will let you know how to go ahead and purchase your ticket for those fights. But that being said, Hoffy, let's get into it, man.
Let's have at it.
The first fight here, Thiago Santos and Alexander Rakic. This is going to be another
this is
one.
I want this to be a five. I want this so bad to be a five round.
I don't know which way to lean on this. I know Santos is the underdog. I know Rakic has the 2-inch reach advantage, but these guys are beasts, are absolute beasts in this light heavyweight division. Up and coming, I think that they are probably both glad that John Bones Jones has gone up to heavyweight. But these two guys are both guys that could be light heavyweight champion of the world at some point here in the very near future.
Yes. I mean, I think it was a split decision for John Jones versus Santos in their championship bout. And he was on a torn ACL for, you know, much of the fight. I think the third through the rest of the fight. So, yeah, I'm high on him. However, this last fight, you know, I don't know if he just dumped the gas tank and, you know, when he had to share a hurt, but he kind of looked tired after that. So I think he's worked on his cardio, and Rakic is a hell of a fighter. He does have that, you know, that great knockout head kick. I think it was like two fights ago, but he's not really a knockout fighter. He's more of a volume decision kind of guy. So I think he hasn't tasted defeat from a knockout. And I feel that he's, you know, going to be a little loose to start, and he's going to throw something, and it's going to allow Santos to counter. And that's when Santos is just going to bull rush him and get him with something that I don't, you know, up against the fence, you know, much similar to Conor McGregor, and just a flurry of punches is going to put him down, and he's not going to let him up.
Yeah. And this, none of these fights here are going to be as bad as that Rosenstrike versus Gane freaking main event last week. I'll tell you right now, these boys are going to go at it. They're not going to sit there and stand and stare at each other for all three rounds. This is going to be a really good fight. I love Santos. I love what he's done. I just think that Rakic is too well-rounded. I think Rakic is going to – he's going to make Santos blow his load in the first round and then just take it to the ground and just destroy him in round two and finish the fight. So I'm going with Rakic in this one.
Yeah, if it goes to a decision, I give it to Rakic. But like I said, I think Santos can hopefully, you know, not dump his entire load this time.
Yeah, yep. And then probably if there is going to be a fight that you're going to be like, wow, that ended quick, it's going to be this one. We have Islam Makhachev. I'm going to mess this guy's name up. Makhachev or Makovich or however you say his last name.
Makovich.
And then you have Drew Dober. Look, Drew Dober, I love the guy's style. I love the guy's heart. I love the way he does the things that he tries to do. However, Makovich is a beast. The kid is a flat-out stud. And I feel like probably by the end of 2022, he's going to be your lightweight champion. And I'm not so sure he's going to lose a fight in the UFC for a very long time. So I'm going with Makovich in this one. He is a heavy, heavy favorite. And this is one of the ones that they got right when they made a favorite.
Yeah, I agree. I don't know how you know, Drew Dober does train in Denver. So he's going to have, you know, the high altitude. So he's not going to gas out. It's going to be, I think, a three-round war. But Islam, like they, you know, he's Khabib's former training partner, and everybody said that Khabib was just sticking around until Islam could take the throne. So a lot of people were surprised when Khabib stepped away so early. And a lot of people say if, you know, Islam somehow like goes on a, you know, if he loses to Drew Dober, that's not going to bring Khabib out to, you know, to right the wrong there. But they're saying if, you know, Islam goes on a little bit of a run and then loses to one of those top five guys, maybe that's when you see Khabib come back, you know, to right the wrong for his buddy. But this kid is like you said, by the end of this year is going to be in title contention for sure.
Do you think we ever see Khabib again? Because I don't.
I don't. I think if Conor somehow, you know, if Conor won, maybe Dana could have. But I don't think money is a thing, and I think it's strictly legacy. I could see him. I could see if maybe Michael Chandler comes out and does another unbelievable performance and knocks somebody else out real quick. I could see him saying, all right, there's somebody. But I don't think unless we see, you know, the George St. Pierre versus Khabib, I think that's the only thing that really gets Khabib out, and I don't think Dana's going to.
I don't think you see Khabib because of the promise he made to his mother. And he's huge on family. Not only that, but he's still very prevalent in MMA. Like he's trying to get MMA to be an Olympic sport right now. He's lobbying for that.
He still has his gym training. Absolutely.
I don't see how that happened. I mean, the Olympics are 2 weeks long. How are you going to get, you know, have a guy fight four or five times in those 2 weeks is the tough one for me. But at
Pride
any rate,
did it.
Yeah. I mean, in UFC, when it first started, it was a weekend long tournament. So it was one of those things where people were nuts, but now it's all about, you know, health and safety of the fighters. I just don't know how they make that happen. I'd love to see it happen, but I don't think we see Khabib back at all, to be honest with you.
I agree.
All right, so moving on with this card, we've got the first of three main events here. Peter Yan versus Aljamain Sterling. Look, I think this is probably the best fight on the card. I really like Aljamain Sterling. I just think he's too cocky. I think that he is one of those guys who I guess I want to say believes his own hype is the best way to put it. And the 4-inch reach advantage is huge. You know, Peter Yan is not a huge guy by any stretch of the imagination. But, I mean, he switches his stance. He comes at you from all angles. He is a stud when you get it to the ground. Aljamain Sterling's best hope to win this fight is to keep it standing up. And so I don't see how Aljamain Sterling can stop Yan from taking him down. So I'm going with Peter Yan in this one.
No, I think we all saw that, you know, Sterling's last fight, you know, it took him 45 seconds or so to take Stan Hagen's back and choke him unconscious. And we saw what he did to Frankie Edgar. Everyone's high on Stan Hagen, and, you know, this guy just beat him. I know Peter Yan just beat Jose Aldo. I know he beat, you know, Faber, but both of those guys are on their way out. He hasn't beaten a legit, you know, contender that I would say is in that top five. I do think wherever this fight goes, Sterling can compete.
Well, he beat Rivera.
Jimmy Rivera?
Yeah.
He lost last week too, didn't he? Jimmy Rivera's, you know, getting up there in age. He's not active. You know, I want to, you know, I'm talking the top guy. You know, this guy beat Sanhagen. He hasn't beaten Sanhagen. So that's why I'm going with Yan, with Sterling. And I think even if it goes to the ground, he can still win. I think Peter Yan is better off to keep it standing than it is for Sterling to keep it standing.
Yeah, I don't, you know, look, Vegas has this at dead even. They don't have a favorite in this match. This is both fighters that are -110. And
I think Sterling's got the best BJJ in the game. I mean, he's a wrestler. So I think that's where, you know, if he can get it to the ground, I think that's where he actually has an advantage.
Right. Yeah. We'll see. I mean, I think that Yan is just, I just think Sterling believes his hype. And I think that's ends up being his downfall as he tries to get too cocky here.
I agree with that, but it was a couple fights ago he got knocked out, and I think that knockout was what, you know, I think that was kind of his wake-up call. So, yes, I think he, you know, he still portrays as cocky, but I think now it's confidence. I think he's he's understood that mistake that he made and, you know, left himself vulnerable for that knockout. So I think he's a lot smarter of a fighter. And I think that's why, you know, even if he goes against Sanhagen again, too, after he beats, you know, if he beats Jan, because we all know Sanhagen's next in line, I think he's still, I think he, you know, wins that one as well.
Yeah. I mean, it's going to be a good one. I can't wait to watch it. But the next one we have here, the second main event of the on the card, Israel Adesanya versus Jan Blachowicz.
No, you got Nunes versus Anderson first.
No, that's the main event. That's the main event. Yeah, I'm positive. Let me just take a look and make sure.
I don't think so. I'm looking at the main card. It's a Nunes version. Yeah, Nunes and then Blachowicz.
All right. Well, we'll get to that one after because
all right. Go at whatever one you want.
I think that Nunes is the main event. Anyway.
I mean, that's just because you like her, but okay.
Maybe. Israel Adesanya and Jan Blachowicz. Look, Adesanya's a beast, man. There's no other way to put it. This guy is the new John Bones Jones. I think that he is going to end this one in the first round. I don't even know if it goes longer than 2 minutes. So I'm taking Adesanya here. The guy has never lost. He's just a stud, man. He has everything that John Bones Jones had coming up. He has everything that John Bones Jones wanted to be, with the exception of Israel Adesanya does not seem like he's going to be the guy that gets himself in trouble with stupid stuff outside of the octagon. So I'm going to go with Israel Adesanya here, and it's not even going to be close.
So I agree. However, I think this fight potentially could be much like not the whole fight, but much like the Yoel Romero versus Adesanya to start. It's already been said that, you know, Adesanya is not going to come in at 205. He'll be less than that. So I think he's just kind of, you know, much like the Romero, kind of going to feel it out and see if Blachowicz comes to him. I don't think, you know, Blachowicz is more of a counter striker, too. So I think it'll be a little bit before Blachowicz wants to go in there, because we saw with Paulo Costa, you know, just running in there. All Adesanya has to do is slip to the left and he just hits you with a, you know, a left right across the jaw. So I think for the first round, it's going to be slow feeling out. I think Adesanya is going to piece up his legs. I think that's definitely going to be where he starts. I think he might work the body as well. And I think in the second round is when he, you know, he gets him with, you know, I think Blachowicz just gets annoyed with, you know, getting pestered and just comes in, you know, with his Polish power. And that's when Adesanya, you know, precision beats power there.
Yeah, I think if it goes to round two, it's just because Adesanya is playing with him. Like, I think
he's going to play with him much of round one. Just, you know, kick the leg, you know, break that leg, take that power, and get him on that back leg, and then he'll, you know, he'll catch him.
Yeah, Adesanya is, he's going to be around for a long time, and he's going to have that belt for a very long time unless he decides to step up in weight classes and relinquish the belt. But Adesanya is a stud. So let's get to what I think is the main event of the evening, even if UFC says it is not. It's Amanda the Goat Nunes versus Megan Anderson. And look, Nunes is just unbelievable. I mean, there's a reason why they call her the GOAT. And she does things in the women's division that I've never seen before. That being said, I'm going to go ahead and put my money down on Megan Anderson. I think Megan Anderson pulls this one out. I think Megan Anderson is one of those that she knows and she respects Amanda Nunes. She knows who she is. She respects the stuff that she's done, but she respects it enough that I just want to say that she knows what's coming and she knows how to defend it and she knows how to beat Amanda Nunes. She can beat you by submission. She can beat you by knockout. She can go toe to toe with you for all five rounds.
She's got a 35% defense rate against no talent. How is she going to defend against a BJJ specialist?
I'm telling you, Megan Anderson is going to find a way to win this fight.
Megan Anderson gets hit. She is going to get hit. She only lands about one strike, you know, one strike per minute to Nunez's 4.5. I think Nunez is going to piece her up, and I think it's going to be over real quick, two or three rounds. I mean, if some of the better women can't beat her, you know, you had Valentina Shevchenko, you had Chris Cyborg. I think those are the only two that stand a chance, and I think Cyborg, you know, it's much like the last fight. Valentina was the only one that, you know, made it somewhat close, and I think that would be a great fight to see. But those two are in a league of their own, and I'm not betting against them.
Yeah, I get it, man. And you know, this is my upset pick of the night for sure. You know, maybe I like it so much because I want to put money down and actually win some on this one. But I really think that Megan Anderson is poised and ready, and I do think that she's
she's too little.
Yeah, but she, you think she's
Nunez is strong, man. Nunez can handle, you know, she could handle me and you together. I mean, she's
5 inches taller. She's got a longer reach advantage. I don't know, man. I really like her. I love, you know, the style that she poses. She's a striker just like Nunez.
Holly Holm had height. Holly Holm had legs, kicks, et cetera, and she freaking kicked Holly Holm right upside the face and took her out on her own on her own weapon. So yeah. I don't see Anderson doing much better than Holly Holm or any of the others.
Right. Well, that's what we have for UFC 259, guys. This is going to be an absolutely amazing card. If any of you guys out there have any questions, want to know a little bit more about UFC, feel free to chime over. You hit me up. We can ask Hoffy here too. You know, but this is going to be a great, great fight. Great card.
I can't wait for Saturday night for sure.
Yeah, for sure. We'll do our pick-ems, and we will be talking trash the whole way, especially if Megan Anderson goes out there and gets that win like I predict.
Yeah, so just like what Combs said, guys, if you guys are interested in watching the fights, you can head over to our Facebook page, facebook.com, and we will post that link Thursday. So Thursday is when you can start to purchase the tickets to watch the fights with us. Manhour on Facebook. It's facebook.com/ManhourSportsTalk. So we'll be right back after the break. Hoffy, we'll lead you out, just like with this, man. Appreciate it.
See you Saturday, boys.
Later.
And welcome back to the Man Hour, guys. Michael Buckeyes along with Brandon Combs. Head over to manhourradio.com and become a member today. You head over to manhourradio.com, click on the members only tab. There you bring up two packages, the gold and silver plan. The silver plan is $3 a month. You get all access to us. You get all access to the blogs. You get to interact with us after the show, on our after show, 10 p.m. East Coast time, Monday through Thursday. And if you get the gold package, that is $5 a month. And after 6 months, you get everything of what you just got, what we just heard, but you also get a hoodie as well, shipped to you after 6 months of service. So, Combs, we have about 15 members right now, I want to say, and it is growing every day. So we are excited for all the members to come through and join us on the after show, 10 p.m. East Coast time at manhourradio.com. So, Combs, that was a great UFC segment. We don't talk a whole lot of UFC on the show, but we like to sprinkle it in every now and then. And you and Hafia had some great conversations there, and it kind of got me excited for Saturday. I'm not going to lie. I'm going to be tuned in at 6 o'clock watching the prelims of the prelims, and then watch the prelims, and then watch the main event. So the pre event is when I'm going to start watching.
Early prelims. The early prelims.
The early bird gets the worm.
Regular prelims. Yeah. But no, even like we were saying, man, even the prelims and the early prelims are going to be great fights. You're not going to want to miss a second of the action. I know it starts a little early, 6 Eastern, 5 o'clock Central here my time. But I'll be tuned in for every single bout. And once it comes to the main event, man, I'll be there talking trash with you guys, watching the main event. It's going to be good. It's going to be a lot of fun. So, look, $5 to see this card is an amazing price. So tell your friends, tell anybody who wants to join. This isn't just for you guys out there right now. Bring everybody you want to come out there and watch this and talk. The bigger this thing is, the more fun it's going to be.
Right, and then on the flip side of that, if you do not have ESPN Plus, we will be offering the early prelims as well. So if we get enough interest on that, that will be streamed starting at 6 o'clock East Coast time. So if you are interested in that, feel free to purchase that ticket as well. However, we have to have at least 5 people in there, or we simply just can't start the stream. It's kind of the regulations of the website. So, Combs, with that being said, speaking of some regulations, spring training is now in full swing. My Kansas City Royals dropped to the Cubs on Tuesday.
Yeah, they did.
Making them 2-2 in a spring training here. But
who's their only loss to?
To the Cubs. But how many wins does the Cubs have on the season?
Two
now? Okay, yeah, so we're still better than – yeah, we're still better than
– we have zero losses, so
– but we still have 3 games, so due to a factor
we're better. 2-1 is still not as good as 2-0.
It's still better because we play more games, so whatever. So with that being said, there have been some rule tweaks that has been happening, one of which where once you throw 25 pitches in a inning and you see you are kind of in like – a no-win situation, get ready to blow an inning open. You can basically call, hey, timeout, inning's over. So this is to basically speed up the spring training aspect of it. And we saw this happen on Tuesday night where in the first inning, a manager, the bases were juiced. He said, oh, my pitcher's in a jam. We're just going to call the inning. So effectively, the pitcher technically got pulled from the game and then returned to the second inning to, pitch more of the game. So, first things first, on Way or No Way yesterday's show, we both, you and I, Combs, agreed that spring training is probably the best preseason of, like, all the sports over NFL, hockey, basketball, etc. Are you okay with them shortening these spring training games with this, quote, mercy rule?
Yeah. Look, I'm okay with it. It's a little bit interesting. It's a little interesting to watch, but look, ultimately spring training is to get ready for the regular season. It's to stretch your guys out, get them used to playing baseball again and games and all that stuff. And then you want to see your young guys and how they react to certain situations. The thing about this rule is that you're not out there to tax your pitchers. That's not what spring training is for. So if you say, hey, look, I've only got, you know, six pitchers with me today. That's how many are throwing. The rest of them are over their limit. It's only spring training. The games don't count. The numbers don't count. None of that stuff counts. And it doesn't take nine innings to see what you want to see from each game. The game that you're there to see isn't to see who wins and who loses. It's to see how people are playing, how guys are reacting, especially the young guys. The older guy, a lot of these guys, you look at your starters, they come out of the game, they leave and they go home in the fourth or fifth inning. They don't even stick around.
Those are the starters, though. Those are the guys that are on a major league team already with, you know, $1 million contract. Right. They aren't fighting to, you know, be on the AAA team, right? So
Exactly. But you don't want to tax your pitchers. You don't want to see a pitcher get hurt because he's got to go, you know, throw 50 pitches in an inning to get out of it. Look, if he's been through 39 pitches and you're like, hey, guys, look, that's enough. We're not going to go through everything and we're only going to, you know, whatever. I guess now another thing they can do is decide before the game whether or not to go nine innings, and they can choose to go seven or maybe even six. I can't remember which one it is, but I'm fine with all of it. It's preseason. I get people pay to go see these games, but on the flip side of that, if you're paying to go to spring training, you're paying for the experience, the before the game where you're talking to players, you know, getting autographs and that stuff. You have more access to the players pre and post game and that type of stuff, and you're closer to the players as well. So that's what people are going to spring training for. You already understand that you're probably not going to see starters play nine innings. You understand you're going there. You're going to see a lot of guys you've never heard before. Some of these guys don't even have names on their backs. So you understand that stuff heading into buying these tickets. So I'm okay with it. You know, there's probably a couple people who don't like it or are disappointed. And those are probably the same, you know, freaking guys are the get off my lawn guys.
Well, get off my lawn, because I spent a lot of money to make my grass green and nice and thick. And, like, I spent a lot of money to my lawnmower to die, like, every row that I push, because there's so much grass in there. Like, I pay a lot of money for that, Combs. So stay off my lawn. But I am kind of on the boat where, okay, so I am okay with the inning shortage. If it is a agreed upon, you know, before the game, saying, hey, we're going to play seven innings. Like, I'm okay with that, 100%. What I'm not okay with is pulling a pitcher or, you know, saying, oh, the bases are loaded. We've already walked in a run. He's got 35 pitches. We're done. We're done here. I don't want to blow this game open. That's exactly the situations that I want to see these young pitchers in. This is the situation that I want to see these young players in. How do they react to adversity when the bases are loaded with a single out and they aren't finding the zone? Because we are going to come to the dog days of summer, and these young pitchers are going to get called up, you know, play a week here because, you know, my starting pitcher has a strained elbow and he needs to be on the 15-day DL, to recover. So I'm going to pull him up, but I don't want to tax my bullpen in the dog days of summer either. So how are you going to react when the bases are juiced, one out, and you aren't finding the zone? That's the exact situation that spring training is all about, Combs.
Yeah, I get it. But I just, when you are in that situation, you don't want, you know, if your guy's in that jam, it's just not his day. And when you are, you know, when you are going through that, you understand that, hey, look, you know, we're not here for that. The games don't count. It doesn't matter.
Okay.
If he's at 29, 30, 35 pitches and he's just not getting the ball over the plate and he can't, for one, if he's starting to lose command of his pitches, what if he throws a pitch because he has no control and hits one of your guys in the head? And now your guy's out because he was taxed. He should have been taken out of the game. Or that's just stuff that you have to think of.
That is all preseason sports, though. That is all preseason sports. Like, you risk the risk of career-ending injuries every time you step on the field, court, like, et cetera. That is just a risk that you take. But let's take the same scenario. Bases are loaded, single out. You've already walked in a run. And the night before, you played till 1 o'clock in the morning. You had to use your middle reliever for four innings. Your closer had to come in and, you know, pitch more than his single inning. He had to pitch, you know, like an inning and two-thirds, right? And so the bullpen is like taxed. And you have this young guy come up to simply, you know, take innings off of the rotation to, you know, burden the load. And I have to see him power through this. You want to be on my AAA team, you have to power through this. You have to dig down deep, find the cojones.
Power through it later on in spring training. But then you put him in, you bring him in those situations. You say, hey, instead of canceling the interview, once one of my other guys gets in trouble, this is the guy I want to bring in because I want to see how he gets out of trouble. So yeah, now he's not throwing over 20 pitches or 30 pitches to do
well,
so.
But
he's coming in fresh to do so.
But like, the difference is you put yourself in that situation. You aren't coming in fresh into that situation. There are two different scenarios there.
Yeah, but let's think about it like this. If you put yourself in that situation and you're getting shelled and you're a relief pitcher anyway, mm-hmm. you're probably getting taken out already anyway. Like, they're bringing in somebody else to relieve you at that point. If you got to the point as a relief pitcher in the seventh or eighth inning where you've loaded the bases or you've given up two or three runs and the bases, there's still runners on base, chances are there's another reliever coming in to take you out anyway.
Well, I'm going to go out on a limb and say there are certain parts of the Major League Baseball season where, you know, it is a 5-0 game, seventh inning. The team that has zero runs, nine times out of ten, is kind of just throwing in a towel anyways, right? So they are going to leave this struggling pitcher in to, you know, say, hey, work yourself out of
but
it,
see,
right?
That's the thing, too, though. These rules, the you can decide to go to seven innings. And you can take the pitcher or you can end the inning or whatever it is. These rules are only there for, like, I think it's the first 2 weeks of spring training. And then after that, it resets and goes back to normal rules. Like, you can't just do that.
Okay. So, I see what you're saying. But on the flip side, like, let's talk about the innings thing here. Would you be okay with that if they did that in, like, the regular season? For, I don't know. Like let's put a cap on it. You know, post All-Star break until September. Would you be okay with them saying, hey, let's play seven innings this particular game?
Timothy Leonard corrects me and says it's a week and a half. So that's even better. I mean, it's a week and a half of being able to do these things. I just have no problem. It's early spring training. Guys are still stretching themselves out, still trying to get ready. You're not trying to tax your guys this early in spring training. So I have zero problem with any of these rules for the first 2 weeks. I just don't.
Okay, so let's go ahead and transition from rules into the actual gameplay. AAA Baseball has said that they will delay the season at least a month because of the whole COVID situation here. Because they need to put things in order, put testing in place and travel, maybe even a bubble type situation as well. Yeah. Do you see Major League Baseball doing the same, pushing the season back to, you know, kind of figure things out?
They've already decided to start on time. They're going to start on time. Minor league baseball, I believe it's 2 weeks after the start of major league regular season is when minor league season starts anyway.
Right.
So they're already 2 weeks after them. To delay it, you know, a couple more weeks, I don't see the problem with it. It's minor league baseball. These guys, if they're getting called up for whatever reason, it'll be called up, you know, after that start anyway. You know, so I don't see major league baseball, you know, doing that at all here. And we've got a question here from Drew who wants to know if Lux and Aquino are going to make it or stay in the minors. That is two different answers for you. So Lux, I believe, is definitely going to make the team right out of spring. I think they're going to give him his shot in the majors. They're not very deep at second base. I think Max Muncy and I think even Mookie Betts are designated on their second base depth chart for the Dodgers. So Gavin Lux is definitely going to get his shot. Aquino is not. So the Reds are so deep in the outfield that I just don't think – I think Aquino starts the season in the minors and – might not even see the majors this year, depending on how they're performing. They signed that the Shogo Akiyama guy in the offseason. They've got him. They've got Jesse Winker, Nick Senzel, and Nick Castellanos. So they are very deep in the outfield. So unless they trade one of those guys or one of those guys isn't performing well and they send them down, then Aquino makes it out of camp. But I think Aquino is left in the minors, and Lux makes the team.
Timothy Leonard disagrees. I have actually read some stuff where like I think like Aquino will be in a major league uniform this season, just because they are just like what you said, they are so deep in the outfield and there are some teams that are pretty thin. Per the reading that I was doing, you know, kind of touching up like on the show here, he's probably going to get traded before the start of the season, actually.
Right. So Aquino, if he does make the major league roster, I mean, that means that they're going to be carrying five, maybe six outfielders. That's a lot of spots to have. Usually, you know, I know that they gave teams an extra roster spot and all that. Most teams are going to use that for a pitcher.
But you should, right?
Yeah, I mean, it's what makes the most sense. I disagree with Timothy Leonard, who says he'll be on the bench at the start of the season. I disagree. I think that he starts in the minors because they're going to want him to get reps. They're going to want him to get at-bats. They're going to want to keep him busy. And then once, you know, if whatever the case is, if Winker is faltering, if this Japanese player that they just signed, Akiyama, if he's not performing well, then yes, Aquino will be up in a heartbeat. But why would you bring him up and leave him on the bench as opposed to sending him down to AAA, letting him get his at-bats, letting him get his reps in, and keeping him fresh? I disagree. I think it makes the most sense to have Aquino start the year out in the minors.
So let me flash back here to the AAA baseball moving their season back at least a month. I saw a comment come across the screen saying that those players will be more injury prone, and that person that said that is exactly right. Because, like Combs, you just said, like, spring training is to get the body acclimated to throwing the ball, getting stretched out, yada, yada, yada. Then you get shut down for a month and a half. Then you're full bore into full games, nine innings, you know, night after night after night. There's going to be so many injuries in AAA this year, I bet. Like, I don't remember who said it. Like, I'd have to scroll back up through the chat again. But that person is exactly right, Combs.
Yeah, I mean, look, I don't know. I don't have a problem with them pushing the season back. I don't see how they're more injury prone.
Because you get warmed up from spring training and then all of a sudden you don't throw a baseball in game situations.
They're not just going to stop moving around. They're still going to be doing simulated games. They're still going to be doing all their stuff. Some of these guys might even stay down in Arizona and have an extended spring training.
So what is the difference between staying down in Arizona and having extended spring training and just starting the season?
There is no difference. But the AAA is the difference between Major League Baseball and the minors. The minors are going to be playing in bubbles.
Right.
Okay? So they're setting up the bubbles. They need time to set up the bubbles. They're doing everything that they can to set up the bubbles, and they need more time to do so. So do I think that there's a problem with them starting right on time? No, I don't. But do I have a problem with them starting, you know, a month late so they can set up the bubble? I have no problem with that either.
You should, because I like minor league baseball better than major league baseball. It's your fault. Yeah, it's your fault, Combs. Yeah.
But you just like to get my blood boiling, so.
Yeah. So speaking of getting blood boiling, Minnesota Vikings fans, how do you guys feel about this? The Minnesota Vikings released Kyle Rudolph today, a 10-year veteran for the Minnesota Vikings. At one point, they nicknamed Kyle Rudolph the red-nosed end zone. Like, because he would find the end zone so much for the Vikings. You as a Bear fans, Colm, and like Wyatt obviously as a Packer fan, he isn't here. You guys are probably on cloud nine that they're releasing Kyle Rudolph, right?
Yeah, I it's surprising. I think that this has, and I know I say it all the time whenever somebody becomes a free agent, that their fan base always thinks that they're going there, but this has New England Patriots written all over it. Yeah. You know, so I was surprised that they released Kyle Rudolph, but at the same time, you know, with a lot of the players that are moving around now, and, you know, maybe the Vikings are freeing up some cap space to make a run at something. I don't know what that Sean is Watson? Just yet. But
like, Juju Jones? Look, like,
I mean, there's a lot of options out there. It could be anything, but yeah.
So you answer my question. Like, you think Kyle Rudolph will end up on a team, and you're thinking the New England Patriots?
Yeah, it just has Patriots written all over it. I mean, there are other teams out there that, you know, could use him. I mean, he would fit great up in Buffalo.
Yeah. Didn't Jared Cook retire this year as well? The Saints.
That I'm not sure of. But he would. Yeah, he'd fit in right there in New Orleans as well.
And the longtime Panthers tied in as well got released / cut. Greg Olsen as well. Yeah. So, I mean, there are two teams that need tight
ends. The Bears have 37 tight ends, so they're not going after him. I know that.
Yeah. It wouldn't be surprised me if they did. Just to add depth, to the 38th guy.
What about the
Colts? Why not? The Colts have that receiver, that tight end. I don't know his name by any means. I'm not even going to try to mention it. But honestly, the Colts are set at every position now because they already have a top 10 quarterback in Carson Wentz. They have some receivers. They have a great offensive line.
What about the Cowboys?
They replaced Jason Witten the year he retired in the draft. I don't know these names, but I do know that they drafted a tight end at fourth or fifth round the year that Jason Witten did retire. And he is arguably now a top five or top 10 tight end in the league. So looking on it at hindsight here, Seattle Seahawks, they need a tight end. I mean, released.
So, I'm looking here at the Cowboys depth chart. You got Blake Jarwin. And Dalton Schultz.
It's Jarwin.
Yeah, I mean, but it's Kyle Rudolph. I mean, Kyle Rudolph, there's nothing wrong with going with a two tight end set, right? I mean, there's lots of teams that are doing that. It's kind of the new NFL now is the two tight end set. So
I would agree with you if the Cowboys did not have three great receivers on that team.
Yeah.
Because when you bring in a second tight end or a third tight end, you either have to take out Amari Cooper or CeeDee Lamb or Michael Gallup. So do you really want to take one of those guys off of the field? I don't think so.
Yeah.
I mean, that'd be tough.
Yeah. I mean, it is. That's why for me this has New England Patriots written all over it.
Yeah.
I mean, they love their tight ends. They love their pass catching.
Well,
tight
don't
ends.
They have they have a Ben Watson, isn't it? Isn't that the tight end's name up there?
No, they don't have Ben Watson anymore. The Patriots
not Ben.
I can't remember who the hell they are.
I am pulling a Combs right now. Like I the name is right there and then I'm like just not getting at him because, I was actually arguing with Combs Jr. during the USC segment here
chat line. They have Matt Lacoste is his name. They are a team that will always run a two tight end set.
Yeah.
But even still, Kyle Rudolph would be the number one tight end in that. That team, in that organization, if he went there. So
you know what else is that kind of has written all over it? A team that's nobody talking about now, but they are now? the Arizona Cardinals, they need a tight end, right? I mean, they are constructing a Super Bowl caliber team down there. They've added J.J. Watt. They're adding more pieces there. They already have a pretty good receiver core with, you know, Hopkins, Fitzgerald, and Isabella, right? I mean, really all they're missing is that dominant tight end almost.
Yeah. You know, that would be something else. You know, I mean, they do have that.
Granted, they need a better quarterback like Deshaun Watson to join the team, but that's here nor there. No.
Yeah. No, they have Dan Arnold over there who they really like. But still, I mean, look, Kyle Rudolph is an upgrade. So, yeah, I guess, you know, I would go there. That would be huge. I mean, look, they need some pieces. You know, they've got Christian Kirk and DeAndre Hopkins. We don't know what Larry Fitzgerald is doing yet.
He's coming back. Like, let's be honest. He is coming back.
Yeah, I mean, I would if I were him. I mean, I chased that ring, and they've got the team to do it. But so if you've got, you know, Fitzgerald, Hopkins, and Kirk, and then you bring in jeez, his name's escaping me. The tight end we're talking about, Rudolph. You bring up Rudolph now, and add him to that mix, man. That's some weapons there for Kyler Murray, or Deshaun Watson.
I mean, only time will tell where Kyle Rudolph is. Like, I don't think he is done in the NFL. He did play 10 seasons. He probably has 4 left in him. 4 great seasons wherever he ends up. So hopefully he finds a team, and you know. He's kind of a guy that I'm secretly rooting for to Renault ring as well, much like you are with Larry Fitzgerald. Kind of a clean nose, just does his job, right?
And that's the thing. Now they got 2 guys you'd be rooting to see them win a title because they got J.J. Watt over there too, and you'd love to see that guy win a ring.
Right. So before we head out, Combs, here on the Man Hour, you guys head over to manhourradio.com. If you miss any part of the show or download us on iTunes, Spotify, and iHeartRadio as well, Illinois thumped Michigan on Tuesday. I mean, they waxed the floor with them. We were talking right here on the Man Hour yesterday that we're saying that Michigan is probably one of the best teams in the NCAA. Does that by dito facto put Illinois the best team in the NCAA boys basketball right now?
No. I mean, Michigan still got that, you know, Michigan's still one of the top teams out there. But I also did mention Illinois when we were talking about the best teams out there. So, look, Illinois still is one of the best teams out there, and they beat Michigan. So, you know,
I'm going to glim and say they are the best team now.
That's a big win versus Michigan. It's just going to help your at-large berth, you know, now come out. If you beat Michigan again, it's going to be in the Big Ten tournament. So, you know, keep doing what you're doing. Illinois got a shot.
All right, guys, so that's going to be it for the Man Hour today. Like I said, head over to manhourradio.com. Become a member as little as $3 a month. You get the after show, which airs Monday through Thursday, 10 p.m. East Coast time on our members-only tab. Combs, any closing thoughts?
Man Hour Nation, rise up.